Good evening, everyone. Hi. It's a great thrill to see such a full house here. Sorry, we need to give a nod over there that we're actually starting to talk. I'm going to introduce myself. Since I was here for 16 months as a student and then stayed for another, 13 years or so. So Brett Steele could not make it tonight, so I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Tom Verebes. The event tonight is one of the few launches. This is the London launch for Masterplanning the Adaptive City, Computational Approaches to Urbanism in the 21st Century, the subtitle. I'm thrilled to be really back at the AA. I'm grateful to the three presenters with me, also contributors to the book, Patrik Schumacher, Chris Lee, and Marina Lathouri. Brett Steele cannot make it tonight, unfortunately. He was going to join us for a panel discussion. But I'm grateful to Brett for the invitation to come to launch the book here. This is the third of five launches. There was a launch in Shanghai, one in Hong Kong, here in London, University of Toronto in November, and also Pratt Institute in November as well. I'm going to steal Brett's time, though. I'm going to do a little bit of a longer intro to the book and the themes and topics surrounding the book, its paradigms and methodologies and various kinds of outcomes. And then there'll be a series of very short presentations by Patrik, Chris, and Marina. And then we'll have a roundtable discussion and questions as well. Okay. So there's the schedule. The book really does traverse conventional disciplinary boundaries between architecture, urbanism, critical theory, complexity, and natural sciences. Computer graphics, programming, and science, and various other fields of knowledge. It's quite speculative. It's not really a conclusion. It's more really an opening up. It's also not a demimonde of a group of insular, homogeneous grouping. It's trying as much as possible to be varied and broad. The book is about cities. Which are in continuous transformation, if ever so slowly. And it's really looking to alternatives beyond what urban planning, a very new discipline, much younger than architecture, has given. And it's looking really for ways in which to theorize and to work through methodologically how to think about the evolutionary nature of cities. Looking at the complexities between duration, obsolescence, resilience and adaptivity. Okay, so the book structure. I'll present a little bit of the book and then some of the paradigms as it goes on. The structure of the book is in four sections. There are four chapters authored by myself, six essays, six conversations, and 18 projects. In discussion with the editor, Wendy Fuller in New York, who wanted a little bit of mixing but was not really up for what I was proposing, was really to create a very sort of a metaphor of the city in some sense. It's intentionally urban, the structure of the book. It's mixed, it's very intense, it's heterogeneous, congested, even cacophonous. So in that sense, it mirrors a contemporary metropolitan experience by relating the authored text with the essays, conversations, and various projects, intentionally creating mixes between various positions, sometimes oppositional positions, between projects and between theory. Okay, so the four sections, the first, endurance, obsolescence, and change, is sort of part theory, part history, looking really at the associative and evolutionary nature of cities in an era of globalization, really, looking at the relationship, say, between networks and globalization, and very much taking a position about assessing and evaluating the status of urbanization in Asia. The second chapter, The Concepts and Paradigms, does really take the principle of uncertainty, that we do live in a time where the complexities of the city and the emergence that forms it and that is an issue of it, really is, in a way, we live in a kind of age of indeterminacy. So it looks at, this chapter really tries to sort out the paradox between planning in a very uncertain world and the relationship between planning and emergence. The third chapter, Methodologies, looks at the kind of information-based toolbox of a contemporary architect and urbanist, and the potential for these sorts of design models and of ways in which the urbanism can be informed. It takes a position about adaptivity and evolutionary change, but also about heterogeneity. We'll elaborate on this. And then the final chapter is more to do with the projections of how to engage with standardization, repetitive models of production of the legacy of Fordism, and to produce multiple futures in a sense of the multiplicities of serial production of post-Fordism, but also multiple futures of the city. Okay. Okay, the various chapters that are authored, I'll just sort of quickly go through these. And you can read the titles, the new. So these are sort of in the four bits, seven different chapters. So even four chapters get messed up. Marina Lathouri's Projective Architectures, The Question of Borders in a Connected World. Georges Fiori on The Informal City. Jonathan Solomon, Public Spheres, writing about the informal networks in Hong Kong. And Patrik Schumacher's Free Market Urbanism, who will present tonight. Peter Trummer's Morphogenetic Urbanism. David Gerber's Parametric Urbanism. And then a number of conversations with Dana Cuff, an urbanist based in LA, Shuwei Guo in Beijing, Matthew Pryor in Hong Kong, Tom Barker, formerly in Australia, now in Toronto, Su Yin Cheng in Shanghai, and Brett Steele upstairs. Okay, so I will go through a little bit of theorization on some of the topics of the book. Now I really need to look at the time. Okay, so the city really as an expression of culture, urbanism does have its roots really in the taming of nature. The first widespread territory to be altered irreversibly is the Nile Delta. So the history of urbanism really is no more than 12,000 years old, might be related to other rivers elsewhere. Don't worry, you haven't come to an anthropology lecture. In this part of the world, in the part of the world where I live, which is this part, specifically in Hong Kong, but within this circle, it's become a little bit of a cliche in the last sort of half year or so to say that, well, half the population of the world lives within this circle. And 75% of the world's urbanites, urban dwellers, live in this country called China. The first mention really of the term world city was in the book Cities in Evolution by Patrick Geddes. And really it's the first urban theorist to argue for the history of cities being one of continual, if not constant, evolutionary change. The term city had, in the 20th century, become antiquated, really, and the number of terms that, you know, whether it's the world city, the megalopolis, the mega city, the global city, etc., by all of the theorists giving various names to it. When Rem Koolhaas starts his research studio at Harvard, he tries to call it the Center for the Study of What Used to Be Called the City. Of course, that's a bit long, and I'm sure that led to all sorts of discussions to shorten it to what we know of the Harvard Project on a City. It seems the term city, in order to engage with what it is we call the city, first needs to be renamed, really. The Truvius's 10 books is maybe the first detailed set of performance criteria, and really a kind of parametric relational manual of how to build cities. Sort of works out, you know, formulas for environmental orientation, exposure, altitude, climate, flora, defenses, etc. Very much an infrastructural kind of position on the city. And the Roman Empire really was a kind of the first very systematic empire to build. They built 5,627 cities in this red area of Europe, North Africa, and the Middle East. And if we look at the map of global shipping about 500 years ago, it begins to map out relationships across the globe and the beginnings of a mapping of globalization. In today's world of flow of goods on the sea, the map looks more like this. Europe's high-speed rail networks, they indicate nodes of intensification, as well as limits and gaps in the network, and the gaps of urbanity. So the black zones are really the most urban. Carrying on this infrastructural strand, in God's Own Junkyard by Peter Blake, this is written 5 years before the famous Venturi's Las Vegas studio, he celebrates the road space of pre-pop America. This is Beijing. Blake's paradigm clearly is not for export. In Beijing, they are still buying about 1,000 cars per day. So the American Strip, celebrated by Venturi and Scott Brown in the mid-60s, represents really the ultimate vehicular space, neither city nor suburb. The retro American pop of the Venturis is also maybe a bit retro. Today, Las Vegas is a theme park, maybe also not for export as a model for urbanism. Okay, so after the explosion of city walls in interconnected Europe, maybe the first sort of... sorry, it's my phone, shit. Arturo Soria y Mata develops the first sort of road town, the linear city, Ciudad Lineal, which is in fact built. Houston, the ultimate in low density sprawl, a city with near absence of any sort of zoning or conventional as a conventionally understood sense, is the antithesis of planning. It is known as and characterized as wild. In contrast, Jonathan Solomon's research on Hong Kong in his essay Public Spheres and also his book Cities Without Ground looks at the informal networks that have grown and evolved in some sense over time and gradually in Hong Kong, the pedestrian kind of links and the networks between shopping and infrastructural spaces. So the ultimate infrastructure of what we've invented, the man-made systems, the global economy, the internet, and other sort of dynamic infrastructures are more integrated into the evolutionary conditions of our planet and seemingly natural. And as Steve Johnson writes in 2001, if cities can generate emergent intelligence, a macro behavior spawned by a million micromotives, what higher forms of higher level form is currently taking shape amongst the routers and fiber optic lines of the internet? Okay. So the complexities of urban change, how do we engage with them? How do we facilitate this sort of new urbanism of adaptivity? Koolhaas in 1994 asserts that the new urbanism, so-called, will not be based on the twin fantasies of order and omnipotence. Sanford Quinter writes of that new urbanism, that it'll be soft, liquid, and grazing, perpetually interacting of forces, free of hard control. The interface of SimCity does try to engage with the relationship between various kinds of dynamic conditions as a sort of form of parametric urbanism, albeit super simplified and reductive in its spatiality. Okay. More on Kuhlhaus. The treatise, which was in a sense sort of gonzo journalistic of the Great Leap Forward, very much celebrated urbanization, the erasure of the old Chinese urbanism, with the new in the Pearl River Delta, research carried out in 96 and published in 2003. It celebrates China's victory really over the past that it seemed to have already forgotten. And in Neville Mars and Adrian Hornsby's The Chinese Dream, they published the before and after photos of, which are actually by now even unrecognizable 5 years later, of Shanghai. And in the same book, Adrian asks where the city went. And 5 years later, another Dutchman, or another couple of Dutchmen ask similar questions, and how the city moved to Mr. Sun. Mr. Sun is a farmer, never moved, but he becomes a property tycoon by building property on his land. Okay, so back to urban Europe. The insularity of European cities, which were designed as defensible and represent the ideality and autonomy of the city, also intensely infrastructural. With industrialization, utopia becomes a social project, fused now with literature, philosophy, political treatises, and no longer really with religion, but industrialization brought on rapid urbanization in Europe. Monotony, brought on maybe by the assembly line, as the kind of default of standardization, is perhaps the greatest residue of the industrial line and its standardization and repetitive production is that of today's cities. The white flight of suburbia in post-war America gives an opportunity for newfound wealth in America to produce repetitive cookie-cutter architecture of suburbia, also not a model for export. Okay, so the paradigm of the New World City seems relevant in this context to discuss. The instant city really is not at all in a new condition. In the Midwest of America, Chicago pops up in the mid-19th century and by the late 19th century at the confluence of the plains of America and the Great Lakes between rail shipping and sea shipping of the Great Lakes out to the St. Lawrence River and the Atlantic Ocean. Really not anything new. In some ways, it's the Shenzhen of the 19th century. And not too different than say Manchester or Liverpool from Europe. So Shenzhen, maybe similar to Chicago in that it's a shock city, like the way Frederick Engels talked about Manchester and Liverpool. It was a town of 20,000 in 1980. Today, it's hard to measure where it stops, but it's somewhere in the region of 15 to 20 million. Looking kind of like that. Okay, so Dubai. George Katadritis's photos from 1992 and 2004. So Chicago has a little bit of parallels, and so does Shenzhen and all of the instant cities with Dubai. As an experiment, it seems highly unlikely to become a standard, repeatable model for urbanization. For a number of reasons, maybe based on programmatic narrative, it's easy to discredit. but it's meant to dazzle, it's meant to create awe, yet it's highly unsustainable on many, many, many levels. It relates to other cities in the past, which are also tenuous. This is an aerial view of the city of Timbuktu. At once a city of gold in the desert in northern Mali in Africa, on the south side of the Sahara. It was for 500 years larger than any other European city. Like Dubai, Timbuktu did not produce anything. It was a city that was a hub between camel caravanserai and boats on the Niger River. It was killed off by sea shipping to the coast of West Africa. Well, killed off. This is when I visited Timbuktu and as a town of 15,000 about 20 years ago, this is what it looked like. Okay, so it's not all rosy with cities. They sometimes decay. Urban change isn't all about growth, and it's not all about celebrating and celebration of glory. Detroit this summer seemed like it was in the largest U.S. bankruptcy ever, and really on the verge of disappearing. I'm sure in 10 years it will be one of the cities on the rise in America. In the same day in the China Daily, being celebrated for being on its last gasp. Okay. So, urbanization and erasure. This guy was, Le Corbusier, was very happy to announce a city of 3 million people to obliterate the center of Paris. And the images of this homogenous urbanization really is replicated all through the world and becomes replicable. Some can read this. This is the Chinese character Chai. It's painted on doorways all across China, and it means destruction or to demolish. And it's a reminder, really, of how material history and the materialization of architecture in the city can be eradicated. Okay, so the ecological model for the city, as Le Corbusier writes in 1921, 93 years ago, that the city is the grip of man on nature. Sorry if that's a bit small from the back. Here's Frank Lloyd Wright and his, published in The Disappearing City, his Broadacre City model, spread across the Jeffersonian grid, promoted as seemingly integrated with so-called nature, but in fact, its low-density sprawl tends to dominate so-called nature. Tange, looking at Tokyo Bay, a kind of manifesto, really, of growth onto Tokyo Bay. Metabolism was maybe more interesting for its kind of understanding of urbanism as something quite living and biological. And when they drew caricatures of the city, it seems actually more akin to the ways in which they thought about it than their actual projects. Maybe it's good to say at this stage that there are some models of urbanization today that are really either not for export or really misguided. The postmodernisms, the neo-traditionalisms of new urbanism really need to be rethought. Ebenezer Howard's The Garden City was looked at as maybe one of the first models of trying to integrate with nature and fix the ills of the city of the 19th century, the industrial city before it. But in some sense today, I think we have much greater pressing issues about the economy, the environment and the relationship to the changing climate of the planet. And this guy, Al Gore, in his Inconvenient Truth, really does set the stage for what it is that urbanists in the 21st century need to confront and see as a set of challenges. And there, beyond our control, there are the vast forces of planet Earth. This is a mapping of the force of the earthquake and tsunami of 2001. And it does also suggest the vast power of the crust of the Earth and also the indeterminacy with which it can affect urbanism. Okay, so here's the dystopic part of the lecture, or mini-lecture. In my own formative images of the future and of the city were formed by scenarios such as in Blade Runner from the 1980s, or Mad Max. More humorous, that of, say, Waterworld a few years ago, where the whole planet is sort of flooded. This is the day after, similar sort of theme. And HSBC, as I go up the gangplank to flights in Hong Kong, tells me that in the future we will be planting cities. Okay, so time, change, and adaptation. So Korb also said the machine is a house for living in. And before the Korb Foundation had rebuilt Villa Savoye, the evidence that architecture doesn't endure and that it does decay. And perhaps we need to find ways in which not just the resilience, but a way in which the city and urban architecture can both endure but also adapt. Okay. Concepts and paradigms of what can be a kind of paradox between planning and emergence, and very dramatically, let's call it the death of master planning and the age of indeterminacy. Architecture Without Architects by Rudofsky, it did demonstrate how informal urbanism or architecture has had a following, of course, but I'll speed up a little bit. But that unplanned urbanism, if we extend that argument to that of a city, this is the Kowloon Walled City, which up until the late 80s, early 90s, was really the densest part of planet Earth without one architect, really. Okay. Bill Mitchell writes that we need to rethink yet again the idea of a city. In Paris, Haussmann redesigns Paris with infrastructure as the tool and adapts the medieval fabric for the control of the people and also for the defense of the city, all in the name of hygiene. Versailles, really the ultimate in planning, of formality, totally top-down, centralized, controlled. In comparison to the gradualism and traditional medieval fabric of Venice, grown incrementally and also not necessarily designed, but rather evolved. Tokyo, a city which is planned, yet also but has wonderful emergent properties, or Kyoto and its grid, Manhattan and its grid. When Kuhlhaas writes about Manhattan in Delirious New York, he talks about it as the culture of congestion, as the ultimate of essential precondition of metropolitan life, and that the grid really is on some level the ultimate controller, but it creates the context within which the freedom of the city and of that of design in increments can be played out. The coherence of a traditional city, in the sense Marrakesh, come from local decisions that amalgamate into a whole, rather than are designed. The whole comes from the sum of its parts, really from a kind of domestic model. Architects are really enamored by evolutionary patterns and by the informal city. It's a relationship really between topography, minimal means, circulation, hydrology. If it weren't for the lack of personal safety, the poverty and the sanitation and hygiene. Actually, the urbanism on the right in the largest slum in the world in Caracas would be seemingly more desirable. And these sorts of famous images of a Brazilian luxury housing estate next to a slum is not so much a question of like the economic and economics and the politics of this image that interests me. It's more the relationship between the unplanned and the highly designed. There are indications that within, say, a city such as Chongqing, which is in next to Sichuan province, the largest municipality in the world at 32 million, the relationship between topography, typologies that need to be adapted, infrastructure that needs to negotiate extremely steep slopes. This all seems really highly associative and relational between these sorts of systems. So where does uncertainty play in this? We do live really in a time where we, in an increasingly uncertain world that is hard to predict. And the complex systems, the last couple of decades, certainly within this sort of context of an architecture school, natural systems have been a source within which not just to inspire the kind of formal order of design, but really drawing on well beyond the kind of the geometric, this has to do with the kind of systemics and of dynamics and of change. Parametric patterns and models of evolution. I think there's a very fundamental difference to the way that Alexander talked about patterns as conventions as the basis of an understanding of familiar tendencies. Since another sort of reading of the 1960s, from say Ockbart onwards, the topic of pattern has led designers to pursue increased complexity, unknown outcomes, that of the unexpected and the unpredictable. Looking at really kind of the way that the whole becomes far greater than the sum of their parts. And really a kind of, there's a fundamental paradigm shift from typology to topology, and a shift maybe from mapping to diagramming, and an understanding really that typology, maybe Chris Lee will unfold some of these issues. A difference really from understanding typology as a way of working that through stability and convention and fixity to a much more mobile and transformational mode of work. Gordon Pask, probably in this very room and lectern, well, he wrote this, but he probably said it as well in this room, that systems, notably cities, grow and develop, and that architecture needs to have rules of evolution built into it for it to be healthy rather than cancerous. Okay, the third section, bear with me. Tools and moving targets. The new toolbox, as Thomas Kuhn writes, that we need, that times of retooling are really kind of crisis, and that it's an extravagance, but we really have retooled. When computers came into architecture, maybe not so dramatically and needing so much manpower as when this electronic computer went into that building half a century ago. But the innovations in contemporary design really have led to all kinds of understandings of what on the right-hand side of this, if we can, on the right-hand side, I don't know if my cursor is working, I don't know where my cursor is, there it is. The right-hand side is really where the design is, the code of the back end of the environment, rather than the front end of the user interface so much. And this is maybe what Pask also talked about, that the designer doesn't so much design the outcome, the designer designs the rules that will allow it to develop and evolve, it being the product. So within this sort of more intelligent and even lifelike approach to design. We worked on an exhibition project where we developed a kind of front-end user interface with a back-end sort of grasshopper model, very simple interface that the visitors to the exhibition could design their own city. And it was based on 10 cities in the Guangdong province in the Pearl River Delta. And so these sorts of differences of simple relationships between programming, footprint, density within a kind of different range of parameters within each of those cities. So models really are informational and capturing information, not unlike the way that Jules-Étienne Marais about a century ago used the notation to capture the dynamics of motion with photography. Darcy Thompson nearly a century ago wrote about the ways in which Cartesian points can be measuring the transformation between the internal code, or DNA as it became known, of a species and its external forces shaping it into evolution in different means and means and ends. The parameter space and solution space, as it relates to urban space, has a kind of history of cybernetics as the understanding of the intelligence of species and machines to communicate and to learn really from feedback. Simondon, in the second order cybernetics, writes more about the interactivity of what we become known to be as interactivity. He also wrote about modulation rather than repetition. It seemingly resonates very much in today's world. Also probably in this very room, John Fraser lectured about and wrote this book as an AA publication called An Evolutionary Architecture. And he did write a little bit about predictive planning models, and he worked with his AA students in the early 70s on a kind of morphogenetic kind of basis of architecture. And Bill Mitchell writes about the idea of the city being based on information and the flow of information a couple of decades ago. Okay. So simulation, back to PASC, so this is back to SimCity, as a relationship between various systems and parameters of the city. SimCity, although not very interesting for its architecture, seems to be a basis upon which the kind of control systems of the way that the designer can interact with real time rather than the kind of fixity of the outcome is perhaps a model worth pursuing, a way in which to build models. Computational urbanism. Through computational approaches, urbanism, I think there's the potential really to inform the city with a variety of kinds of effects, a variety of systems, a way in which to create emergent possibilities, a way in which one can not just design one single instance, but to see the city as potentially growing and changing and not just adapting, but also quite heterogeneous in its locales. Rather than the alien imposition of figures in the city, here are a number of kind of student projects that I'll just show, like one image from each of these student projects. This was negotiating the relationship between the old town in Shanghai and the high-rise towers on its periphery. Far from really a blueprint of management for urban growth, computational urbanism maybe is a more pliant and sentient way of understanding urbanism, far more fine-grained, far more able to respond to local specificities. Once again, reading the city as patterns, maybe both spatially as well as temporally. Multiple systems, or the ways in which a relationship between the dynamics of the city. This was a project for rebuilding coastal Japan, a number of systems to kind of break waves and seismic systems, rather than preventative and hostile in design, but to really see them as relational and interactive between a number of systems. The term code seems to have a number of different kind of ways of thinking about them and working with code. I'll sort of move on, projections. The prototypical ways of working. Also in, you know, just outside here about 5 years ago, much of the CSA space pavilion by Alvin Huang and Alan Dempsey, although this makes it, the construction of that pavilion look really quite easy, I think there's a potential of scaling up these sorts of quite small scale experiments between the scripted modeling, the engaging with engineering, the prototyping, and the actual small scale piece, not to discredit the intense skill and the hard work that goes into achieving such a really a beautiful pavilion, but I think there's a potential for scaling up these sorts of prototypical ways of working materially towards that of the city. Okay. Now maybe Chris will have a little bit more to say on typology. In this series, looking at four very different existing buildings in Dongguan on a 500 by 500 meter patch, is scripted a series of instances, each one accumulations and proximities that play out abstractly, yet are basing itself on a kind of topological transformational understanding of beginning with four existing types or models as seeds. I'm coming close to the, well, not the end, maybe the beginning. Okay. There's an argument in this book about icons. And I think the icon is really a kind of tricky, dodgy subject today. It brings out all sorts of political debates about, you know, commercialization and commodification of architecture. But I think the history of architecture is on many levels a history of icons. Icons, well, I won't go through this project too much. But I think icons are important for the endurance and resilience of architecture. It really is what it is we appreciate about the history and the legacy of cities, that of significant special moments. And maybe lastly, the relationship between control, resilience, and change. This book, in some sense, for me personally, even though it's a highly complex, multi-authored and multi-contributor book, it completes maybe a kind of 20-year journey in urbanism, which began at the AA with Jeff Kipnis while I was a student here, where we designed a city of 64 square kilometers outside Haikou City in Hainan Island, with the basis of having to invent new techniques, albeit without computers. This was all a model on the left and hand drawing on the right. And the basis of understanding the mix between the flows of circulation in the city, the landscapes and architectural moments were played out in very conventional models and drawings. And maybe a more recent project in our office, a 25 square kilometer master plan, where we looked at existing kind of topographical features of that could play out the grid and the mega block, which was a requirement of the client between 160 and 200 meters squared grid, and then playing out ways in which the programming would be highly mixed, and then the building heights of and other sorts of zoning conditions would also be heterogeneous. And rather than giving the client one fixed condition, it was three instances of different kinds of densities and different mixes of different ground footprints and such. And then the client was also very interested in the ways in which landscape would be configured, and between linear parks, between pocket parks or private gardens, between more centralized and more diffused, more linear and more diffused. And so these sorts of diagrams of percentages and different characters were sampled and then played out in ways of looking at low, medium, and high densities and ground footprints. And this project sort of presents the potential for both adaptivity as well as intense heterogeneity across the block structure of the city. Okay, now very briefly, I've talked about a lot about the theorization of the city, introduced a bit of the conversations and the essays. And I don't want to take up too much more time. I've gone over my half an hour. But briefly on the projects and the kinds of practices and the sorts of work. In most of or all of the projects really are in Asia, if not in China. The Qianhai Master Plan in Shenzhen by James Corner Field Operations. Plasma Studio Ground Labs, Flowing Gardens, the Xi'an Horticultural Expo, a built project in Xi'an, in China. In our office, Ocean CN, a kind of research project on scripted urbanism. Dot A's Kaili Master Plan in Guizhou Province in Western China, reading the landscape and then developing kind of morphologies related to the topography of the landscape. That which I showed, the parametric Pearl River Delta. Rocker Lang's research project on genetic towers, looking at the relationship of mass and open space and circulation of a series of highly differentiated housing towers. Juanran 4D City project, and Group 8 Kaiserots, associative logic and model for developing varied block structures, and Peter Trummer's research on kind of algorithmic urbanism, and a project we did for the Venice Biennale looking at a range of Hong Kong housing types and ways in which they could be re-articulated and varied. And another research project looking at the endurance and the obsolescence of the city and a range of different kinds of modeling interfaces and ways of developing a kind of variation and a kind of highly specialized outcomes from a series of systems. And Ground Labs, Longgang Master Plan in Shenzhen. And Chris Lee's Siri Architects, remodeling of a factory building in Hangzhou in China. And XWG Studios, remodeling of a shopping street in Beijing. And lastly, MAD's Ordos Museum. I'm not showing the museum itself, but rather the four images or photos that show the development of the forecourt in front of the museum from a Mongolian desert to a Mongolian desert with a few buildings on it in a matter of 5 years or so. And our border crossing facility between Shenzhen and Hong Kong. And lastly, a research project for the Shenzhen Biennale a couple of years ago, looking at a city between Hong Kong and Macau, linking up to the Hong Kong Zhuhai Bridge, where industry, housing, factories, and energy harvesting would try to save the planet. I would really just like to conclude now and really open it up to my three collaborators in the room in the book. Cities do grow. They transform. They fall into decline. Sometimes they are abandoned and even disappear. The future does lie between planning and emergence, between top-down control and a degree of self-organization. Maybe to reiterate the paradox between the wishful permanence that is complicated with the inescapable temporality of urbanism, and that letting go does not specifically entail giving up all aspects of control. One of the battles I fought with the publisher, which is not many, but I'll just conclude with this, the only other battle, was to not write a conclusion to the book. And I thought it was important not to, because I thought that a book that focuses on the relevance of pursuing conclusive, determinable projections of the future is really sort of questionable, and that it was ironic to be asked to write a conclusion in effect on a thesis that argues against conclusions. So I would now welcome Marina, Chris, and Patrik to present, and then we'll have a very inclusive conversation with yourselves and take questions and discussion. Thank you.
Good evening. I would like to start by giving a big thank you to Tom, who has invited me to be part of the project. And although I'm hardly the person to be associated either with master planning or computational urbanism, nevertheless, I think what the book does and what I think Tom described in a very fascinating way opens up a set of questions and opens up the discussion. In this sense, and I would repeat Tom's last words in the book, where he says that it's not about giving answers, providing answers, but it's about posing questions, and it's not about confirming solutions, but it's about posing and outlining new problems. And I think that's very necessary and that's very critical nowadays, that we are addressing and encountering continuing urban growth. And of course there have been, as Tom showed very well, there have been numerous and very elaborate arguments on cities, urban design, economic policies, ecological strategies, sustainable development patterns, and so on. So many that one has difficulty to keep contact with everything which has been said or is being said about the city. In one way, what is my interest, and I think somehow lacks, or I find it lacking in all of these debates and arguments and projects about the city, is a much more fundamental question: what or how we can understand the city, or how, what we mean by the term city. Already Tom said that we keep on using the term city for everything, although many, many people have already confirmed or have already hinted at the inadequacy or irrelevance of the term to a number of current phenomena conditions. But nevertheless, we still use the same vocabulary, we still use the term city to describe very new phenomena and very new conditions. So what I would like to do in this little time we have and I have in today's presentation, it's just to point out two issues which I think they are underlying most of the debates and most of the arguments and most of the projects of the book, and just try to pose a question, to present an argument, more for to contribute to the discussion. And it's partly the argument I tried to develop in my essay in the book. The two issues, terms which I found prominent in the book are the notions of change and the notion of, or the idea of flow. And I would like to start by saying, or by even arguing, that both change and flow, they are inherent to the discipline, to the practice of planning throughout its history. So these are not new issues, these are not new questions. And in fact, planning as a very current practice, planning as a very modern, a recent discipline, which developed only in the 19th century, so I don't talk about the history of the city, but about the history of urban planning, aimed to exactly to do that, to forecast and regulate urban change and growth. So planning was not meant to design cities, but was meant to develop a certain type of development of the city. So in other words, the dimension of time, of the evolution and transformation of the cities, and the management in time of the diversity of external forces, economic, political, cultural, ecological forces, have always been the subject of urban planning, of the practice of planning. And in fact, this is exactly what the term planning meant when it was first used in the 19th century, to delineate future developments within a present plan. So also the term planning was always associated with two other terms, which perhaps now appear as self-evident to us, but the implications are quite complex, and the terms are to the distribution. So planning was about distributing land, population, services, infrastructure, and the other is to dispose, to put things, a diversity of things, in a certain order and in relation to each other. So as I said, they appear quite simple and evident, but actually the implications of these terms and what they signify is quite complex. The first main implication is that once we talk about distribution and disposition, we embrace or we include, engage all scales at once. So that means that every physical, from every scale, from the tiniest physical entity to the scale of the city, to the scale of the region, can be disposed, organized, managed, and therefore also controlled and predicted. The other implication of that is that the city is being thought as an open an open-ended system, a growing, evolving organism. So an open and dynamic system. Can I perhaps? Yeah, thank you. And just to recall once more the plan that Ildefonso de Cerda had made in 1859, and his theory, the general theory of urbanization in 1869, which was to support the project for the extension of the city of Barcelona, and in which text we find for first time the term urbanization. And just to remind, because I know that it's very familiar to you, but just to remind that what he sought to do here was to make a plan for a city without limits, with no definite limits, while predicting and anticipating the future growth of the city, and while anticipating the planning of the region. So in this process, within the rationale of this practice, which expands in one way from the scale of the unit to the scale of geography, from the scale of the intimate to the scale of the region and geography, the aim is to, in my view, to capitalize territory over time, rather than structure a space within a well-defined field, a well-defined programmatically and functionally field. And in one way, to produce arrangements which connect the individual to multiplicities, which connect systems of inhabitation to the production of a larger territory. And I think that's the core of the practice of the technique of planning. So of course, in this technique, in this process, what becomes very important and essential is the issue of connectivity, mobility, and later, a most powerful expression of it, the idea of flow. And that brings me to the second main point of this book, or premise of this book. Again, the idea of connectivity and mobility has been essential to the history of planning. At the beginning, it had a very instrumental form. It was about circulation and organized circulation. But later on, the idea of flow, somehow combining a natural economy with efficiency, became one of the most powerful metaphors to visualize the city and to visualize ideas about the city as an ever-expanding territory, as an open and infinite system. Again, Tom had before the slide on Linear City of Arturo Soriemata, where here the city develops as a road town across Europe. It's meant actually to connect all Europe. So here the city is a system, becomes a system of connection, the city itself. It's to connect, it's transnational. And not only does it have boundaries, but it's also to transcend the boundaries of the nations. And again, another one, Hilbert Simon, The City in the Landscape, where he writes that when seen from the air, the city is not but a system of relational flows. So while this power and the structuring function of these two ideas, change and flow and connectivity, is to bring together, to connect, to fasten together multiple territories. Nevertheless, what I want to argue now and pose as a new problem, or as an old problem but in a new form, is that actually the flow for me doesn't always indicate, doesn't always mean a smooth continuity which only connects, but above all is the ceaseless moving of the boundaries. So I would like, as I said, as part of a possible argument for discussion, to reinstate or to reframe the idea of flow not as something which aim is to connect and create, produce a smoother space, expanse, but as something which is actually, which constantly moves the boundaries and therefore constantly disrupts the relationship between people and territory. So in this sense, despite the fact that flow, the imagery of flow, is resting on the very open and dynamic nature of contemporary processes of both economic and cultural activity, I think that at the same time it transforms the city into, paradoxically, into a permanent frontier zone. And again, the question of border and the question of frontier zone, it's not new, it's as old as the idea of the city. And just to mention one, again, to remind you of one significant, very early example of the function of the line of demarcation, of the line of the boundary, it's when in the rights, in the foundation rights of the city of Rome, they were using boundary stones, the so-called termini, not in order to mark the boundary of a property or to mark the boundary of the city, but in order to demarcate, to delineate a zone within which all things were subject to the authority of Roman state. So they were subject to Roman law. And here we have what actually I think it's very interesting dimension of the discussion is the issue of legality and the multiple statutes and regimes of law which we have to address and encounter in our practice. So in and that was in the old city of Rome, but now at an age of a never almost infinite connectedness, transnational urban systems is like the way the sociologist Saskia Sassen describes actually the cities of today, the global cities, as transnational urban systems. So transnational urban systems, they are not deprived of limit, as we may tend to think. But on the contrary, we have multiple and constantly evolving demarcations of the singular and the multiple, the individual and the collective, the globalized local and the localized global. So I think within this hyper-connected, mobile, self-organizing, self-regulating form of a global market and transboundary and often notional public space, I think the question of the frontier, the question of the border, of the demarcation, can be introduced as a very critical agent and actor, and actually as a very essential parameter in within the design and the architectural project. And it's there in the articulation of these internal territories, in these internal geographies, which I can still see the possibility of the architectural project. Not on the level so much of the master planning, but on the level of the organization and articulation of this eternal, constantly evolving territories. So I would say, as to finish with a sentence which may come closer to the statement of an argument, that I would more put forward for discussion a more strategic positioning of the multiple according to the particularities of local issues, local policies, and local practices, rather than the management of the indeterminate, which was, as I tried to show very, very briefly and very roughly, at the very beginnings of the practice of planning, of master planning. So thank you. That would be my contribution for now.
Okay, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm Chris Lee. I used to teach here, so it's and it used to be a student here as well. So it brings me great pleasure to be back. Thanks, Tom, for including me in the book. Of course, when Tom asked me to contribute to the book and also to present here, I was a little bit nervous because I'm not quite certain as to the validity of my membership in this group. I think Patrik is going to query me on that. But perhaps I have something to say about the city, and I have something to say about the adaptive nature of cities. So I've titled it Notes on the Adaptive Nature of the City. Computers are involved, of course, in the work that I do, but perhaps not. It's not computational. So the very genesis in which I want that sparks my interest in the notion of the city and its adaptive nature is that I would maintain that the city's architecture has always been adaptive, with or without the complicit or conscious involvement of the architect. And to prove this, perhaps I would, in a way, go back to the very fundamental way in which we define the city and the way in which we understand what is the idea of the city. This is also, in a way, informed by my recent incursions and in a way work in China, and especially in cities in Far East China that has a Confucius base. And in a way, it allows me or forced me to make a comparative fundamental difference between my part being a rational approach, which is very Western in terms of its approach to architecture and the view of the city, and one in which is informed by the way in which Chinese civilization, through its philosophical concepts as well as cultural and political concepts, affect the way we look at the city. So very simply, I think we could understand the adaptive nature of the architecture of the city. I may need some help here. That's mine. Okay, all right, got it. Okay, I think this slide really says a lot from, and we learn from Rossi, in which I can project that the way in which Rossi talks about the urban artifact is the way in which we can understand the adaptive nature of the structure of the city. Rossi proposes the way to read the city is to read it through its urban artifacts. And there are two urban artifacts. One is housing, and one is the monument of the city. And he argues here the urban artifact as monument as being an element which is permanent as well as in propelling in the city. And he argues that it is both permanent and propelling, and therefore I argue adaptive, precisely because this structure is independent of programmatic failure. It is transparent of function. What it means by that is that Palazzo di Ragione here, for instance, have undergone programmatic changes from a residence for aristocrats to an army barracks to a market to a school. So according to Rossi, a structure like this is a structure that is permanent but is continually involved in the growth and transformation of the city, thereby making a permanent structure as well as a propelling structure. So I think this is an example in which we see the way in which an architecture of the city or the structure of the city here, that is one that is adaptive and that's one that speaks of the possibility of a structure that acts as a vessel for the collective memory of the city, thereby making it into a common object of its citizens. And of course, reading the architecture of the city as both housing and monument in a way informs the way we understand the very genesis of the historical European city, going back all the way to the Greek city, to Acropolis, to Aristotle's definition of the city as the space of partnership, and in which its architecture and its structure manifests itself as two things, the dialectics of rule and exception, the rule of course being the housing, the homogeneous building type, the similar building types that creates the fabric of the city, and the moment of exception, which is the moment of monument, as the reification of the consensus or the reification of the resolution of the conflict of the space of plurality. Now of course I would argue that in China that's not the case, there's no rule and exception. Prior to 1948, most Chinese cities are designed this way, as imperial cities. There's only rule without the exception. Why I argue that it's only rule without the exception simply is because the entire city is created of one dominant type, one common structure, the quadrangle house. The quadrangle house should not be confused as a courtyard block, like a Berlin block that is with a void carved out, but it's an accumulation of a multitude of pavilions, in which the courtyard only comes into existence when a wall is placed around four pavilions. And of course we see that similar to Ross's notion of a deep structure that is transparent to function, we could also say that the same type, the quadrangle house here, houses all functions of the city, in the imperial city, from dwellings, private dwellings, to schools, to clinics, and of course to the seat of the emperor. It houses the same deep structure, so the only difference when one moves from one function to the other is its scalability, its nested nature with regards to its deep structure, and also with the use of plinths, different pavilions in its scaling gets elevated to make that distinction. So we could also argue, therefore, that the way in which we understand the idea of the city in Chinese civilization, it is that it is a structure that reifies not the resolution of conflict towards consensus, but is in the very nature of Chinese civilization seeing as that all philosophical concepts of society, culture, and so on and so forth is not emancipatory, that everything belongs to one heaven. And it is the interrelation and the resolution and the alternation between binary opposites towards creating harmony that structures almost all aesthetic, cultural, political construct of Chinese civilization. And of course, we could see that ancient Chinese cities are always preceded by a diagram or a master plan. And of course, it simply demonstrates that the state takes on a moral leadership in creating all in regulating all aspects of life. And the city here, therefore, I could say that it is one that could be understood, or rather its adaptivity can be understood as being coming from the city being able to act as a common framework. So therefore, if I have to make a very quick conclusion, I would argue that the adaptive nature of the architecture of the city on the left is about the ability of the object or a singular type to affect change and to absorb change. And of course, with the diagram on the left is the question of the city acting as a common framework with a singular deep structure that adapts program and function. So, of course, with the singular project that Tom asked me to put in the book, I can't answer all the questions that I've raised, but simply we were asked in a way to look at a master plan in Hangzhou in which a post-industrial site comprising of several factories were to be converted, and these factories would create a center for a larger master plan. This move is quite common now in China. You see it all throughout China. So the building that we were asked to conserve is quite a beautiful factory in which on the outside, the very beautiful concrete structure in which iron ore was brought into the factory. But of course, what's most beautiful is the center structure in which the large volume was left empty when we visited this building. Of course, being a developmental city, most urban regeneration projects in China requires a speculative model, and in which we were asked to fill the entire factory with almost 8,000 square meter of GFA. So we thought that to fill the factory with such amount of real estate and commercial function would really be a crime and removes the very beauty and the permanence of the structure. So instead, we said no to filling the factory, but instead to distribute the program as a flat plinth and a podium that surrounds the factory. So thereby, in a way, allowing the factory to be elevated, not unlike the example that I've seen, and in which the podium here acts as both a podium that absorbs all the GFA and program that is required, but also creates a plinth that frames and elevates the factory, increasing its status. And of course, most importantly, what it does is that it frees the internal volume, and in which the internal volume could be open to the public, being taken away completely from the profit-making program of the developer. And further, the plinth is also reimagined as an alternation between solid and void, which is to say the courtyard, in which on the outside, courtyards are created to bring greenery and water into the deep plants, but on the inside, it is inverted to create pavilions. And of course, the plinth is not is also modulated in a sense to punctuate different entrances to the factory on the long side as well as on the short side. And of course, ultimately, the undulating plinth allows the residents of Hangzhou to actually come close in contact with the old factory, but also being able, as I said, to frame the factory and becomes a clear punctuator within the larger urban plan. So if I have to conclude very quickly, I would say that precisely is the adaptive nature of the city can be quite instrumental in the way we think about the city today. And it is adaptive if we think about the city both as a discursive idea and as a pliable deep structure of the city. Thank you.
Sorry, guys. 1, 2, 3. It's okay, it's just...
It won't be recorded.
Really? Okay, then go ahead.
I
Welcome, everybody. 10 minutes to go before we enter the debate. So I come with a question as well, which comes out of the article I was contributing to Thomas' book. So the question is basically, after having worked on parametric urbanism and expressing the intention to enhance the degree of order in the built environment through the new computational techniques, the question comes, is that really possible? Is that really viable in a world where less and less planning authority is delivered and more of urbanization is left to free market play of forces in the market? So is urbanism at all possible in the face of free market dynamism, could be asked. But in particular is parametric urbanism, that increased degree of order which we are aspiring to, possible. And I mean, I'm posing questions, but I also, my answer is yes. I think we need to, that's the only answer possible, because I've been investing 10 years into that project before worrying too much about its viability. But I try to argue how it is possible, why it might be possible, and that, in fact, urbanism is only possible through what I call parametricist urbanism, through the principles of parametericism. Because I believe that, for once, one premise of this is that it's not viable and not likely that there is an increase in planning authority on the one hand. So it's not through power and imposition of a master plan and a plan that we impose or arrive at a higher level of urban order. So that's one premise. So I'm subscribing, in a sense, to that free market condition under which we see urbanism evolving, or let's say urbanization evolving. That's premise A. The second premise is, for me, that urbanization is intensifying. What Thomas said now, half of the total population has been urbanized. And this will continue, and it will continue, I believe, through the process of concentration of urban populations in megacities. And I believe that secondary and tertiary cities and smaller towns will be emptying out as much as the rural areas emptying out, and that there's a massive concentration in megacities, and that this should be so, because I think there is an understanding that productivity increases are possible through intensification of communication in megacities. And those who remain in the provinces and the smaller cities somehow compromising their own vitality and productivity and engagement in contemporary civilization and its advancement. And to some extent, the amount of planning that there remains politically, so are we talking about a process of transformation from Fordism to post-Fordism to what I call post-Fordist network society, which is an erosion of central planning and democratic centralism and an empowerment of markets and individual initiative and emergent patterns, that is going on, and so far I would say hampered by the residues of planning. And my speculation is to erode these residues of politics trying to kind of constrain and predict and control. I think that is fallacious and leading to backwardness and being left behind. So the premise here is of a much more radicalized absence of all planning, and yet at the same time wanting to increase the degree of order in the urbanism. Now I have only three more slides, or two more slides, and I've just lost my notes. Out of here. Because since if I'm not using paper at that point, I will not be able to stick to my time schedule. So, and you can look at that, but I'm going through some of those theses. So I'm saying that around 1980, large-scale planned city expansion vanished in the advanced economies, and with it vanished the discipline of urbanism, urban design, as we know it from the modernists. So this disappearance of modern urbanism is a moment, I think, of a general crisis of modernism, which in itself is but a moment of the crisis of Fordism, understood as the era of mechanical mass production of a national consumption standard within a planned or mixed economy under the auspices of either socialist or social democratic politics. So the last 30 years, that's a process of transformation of crisis and beyond crisis. So the last 30 years since have been marked by the reassertion of market forces, clearly. Post-Fordist flexible specialization driven by the microelectronic revolution in production systems. This is kind of the material underpinning of this. And it has been marked by globalization under the auspices of a neoliberal politics. And of course, a lot of urbanists, urban geography thinkers, and people, academics, hate that fact and polemicize against this. And think of it as a form of regression. But my sensibility as a designer and somebody who's engaged in the real world, I want to premise my architectural thinking on political realities, not on kind of counter stance, lamenting or fighting against historical developments. So I'm, in a sense, accepting that we have a vanishing of any form of planning, social, economic, urban, spatial, and that we have a kind of these market forces are represented in a, also in a political arena with the so-called neoliberal politics. So in terms of urban development, this implies the return, on the one hand, this kind of demise of modernism and post-Fordism meant two things. On the one hand, the return to historic centers with individual incisions. It's the outside kind of big expansion plans. And on the other hand, they meant a kind of deregulated, laissez-faire sprawling beyond the bounds of the cities. And just to pinpoint some of these, so this is this kind of era of Fordism, the monotony, the planned and predictable expansion. It's kind of filling out of squares with and mass reproduction. This was the prior era of Baroque mercantilist absolute state planning of large administrative structures as Versailles, but there's whole cities like Karlsruhe, etc., built like this. And then beyond that, we're looking at postmodernism, the kind of first reaction of architecture to this post-Fordist trajectory of freedom of play of markets, of individuals, of entrepreneurs. And the result of that is, in a sense, what I call garbage spill urbanization. So that we have, in a sense, a trajectory of increasing degrees of freedom to accommodate an increasing complexity and richness and versatility of social phenomena, with an erosion of ordering capacities and ordering principles. We just kind of enhance degrees of freedom by reducing control and order. So both these tendencies, the kind of going back into the historic center with individual incisions, as well as this kind of laissez-faire sprawling, can be described as forms of collage. And collage is, in a sense, an anti-method, an anti-planning. It's just an agglomeration of differences, of arbitrary agglomerations, a kind of anything goes attitude. And the result is what I've called garbage fill urbanism. This was more adaptive and attuned to the new social dynamics than the simplistic, monotonous orders of modernist planning and urbanism. So this replaced this is rational and meaningful with respect to the socioeconomic development. So while the new diversity and open-endedness of social phenomena was registered by the agglomeration of differences, this agglomeration produced the global effect of white noise sameness everywhere without the emergence of distinct identities. So, I mean, I'm comparing this. This is very rich and diverse, and each garbage fill is different, but you can't recognize the difference, neither within them nor between them. So this becomes that homogeneous sameness and that lack of identity which we lament. A lot of people lament everywhere. That sameness is, in fact, just a kind of disorderly agglomeration of lots of diversity and difference. It's just not articulate, not brought under the spell of some kind of ordering principles. So the central question, again, is whether there's something beyond that possible under the condition of an, in fact, radicalized free market conditioning of all urban developments. And my answer is yes, it is possible. How is it possible? So I'm just showing this image here, in fact, that both postmodernism and then deconstructivism in a radicalized sense are, in a sense, aestheticization aesthetic celebration and the ideology, the aesthetic ideology of this kind of laissez-faire garbage spill urbanism is delivered by deconstructivism. Yeah, deconstructivism is the ideology of this process of garbage spill collage. So if I go through this once more, I'm saying, like the move from classicism to modernism, the move from modernism to deconstructivism and collage delivered an expansion of degrees of freedom and versatility to accommodate a more complex and versatile society. And that increase of degrees of freedom and versatility was paid for by a relaxation or rejection of rules of composition. And that means the rejection of means of ordering, and thus a resultant degeneration of the visual order of space. And the move here, what was rejected from the move of from classicism to modernism, was the ordering principle of symmetry and proportion is out. So we have more degrees of freedom. We don't have to adhere to symmetry and proportion. We are free to stretch forever. We have no symmetries. We can agglomerate more freely. But we still have a series of rules of repetition, seriality, orthogonality, etc. But as you move from here to here, these compositional principles of modernism, which are much more reduced, have been further eroded. And therefore, we're needing this kind of degrees of freedom are paid for by a degeneration of the ordering capacity of the discipline. And now comes my argument. Parametricism, I believe is the first style that delivers further degrees of freedom. I think there is an increased versatility and repertoire and morphological moves and ways of creating spaces. That this further increase of degrees of freedom and versatility happens in conjunction with new compositional rules, like the search for continuities, like gradients, like associative logics, etc. And yeah, that we suddenly can combine that increase of degrees of freedom with an increase in the ordering capacity, and therefore an increase in the legibility and order of the built environment simultaneously. So we can kind of break across that antithesis. In a principle, as you know, with those who are familiar with the principles of parametricism and new methodologies of ways of working, that everything is now rule-based, and we're seeking out continuities, variations through gradients, lawful transformations, associative logics. Even if they have multiple ontologies, they're resonant and correspond with each other, they're set into correlative trajectory with each other, make each other transparent, etc. So there's an increase of ordering capacity, simultaneous an increase of degrees of freedom. Now, stepping back things start to look like that. And I will have to come back to that. Now, going back to the market process is an evolutionary process that operates via mutation, trial and error, selection and reproduction. It's a self-correcting, self-regulating,
process leads to kind of self-organized order on the level of the social process and programmatic distribution, because that is left to the market, I believe it should be. So I'm, in a sense, bracketing off all, even the most abstract attempts at land use allocation. I think these can only lead to distortions and fallacies. So all of that is given over to a kind of free play of entrepreneurial forces. So talking about the market process, we might presume that, and that is my hypothesis, extrapolating what has been going on the last 30 years, that the land use allocation and that thus the programmatic dimension of the urban architectural order is to be determined by architecture's private client within the market process that allocates land resources to the most valued users through the price mechanism and free bidding in an open market process. So there's some kind of underlying order which I propose will emerge more than we actually have now, a real programmatic order. But this order will still most probably, it still looks like this in an even more radical sense. So you have to distinguish between underlying social and programmatic order and a kind of articulated spatial morphological order which is absent. So I'm arguing that in the absence of stylistic and methodological coherence of all the architects engaged and hired in this process, we cannot expect the underlying programmatic order to become legible as a spatio-morphological order. For this to happen, we must presume, and that comes my kind of solution to this issue and problem, because this is truly a problem, because it is not only a kind of something we perhaps dislike, but this is dysfunctional for the very processes which try to operate in the city. The city relies on intensification of communication, of us roaming around, set free by mobile phones, continuously browsing the urban environment, looking for communication partners, multiple events simultaneously. We need to read the environment. We need to admit to become transparent, legible, navigable, orientable. We need to quickly intuitively make distinction, approach this rather than that space. So this is, in a sense, getting in the way of the real functioning. So what I'm saying is that the appearance and the legibility and the visual order becomes an aspect in the underlying functionality, social functionality of the built environment as a now mega city, super dense, super diversified and intricate, differentiated in terms of its social programs. These need to be navigated, found, and so that people can gather in relevant communication situations. So that visual order is absolutely important for the social functionality of the built environment. And that is our core competency as architects. We are in charge not of the kind of infrastructural guts and technical functionality of heating and delivering physically matter and materials through all these places, but we are in charge of attractability, perceptual palpability, comprehensibility, and communicative capacity and effectiveness of the built environment, because that's what the community-intensive paradigmatic network society depends on. So neither hegemonic postmodernism, but it has to be parametricism. I think, first of all, there has to be coherence, and the style has to become hegemonic. Because otherwise, when every architect is working with a different style, with a kind of incredibly rich set of material palettes and choices, and nothing, there's no coherent form functions correlations becoming legible, and everything becomes kind of polluted, confused, and chaos, we need a kind of hegemonic style like modernism, which was, in a sense, much more legible than contemporary condition. But it can't be just any of the styles. It can't be going back to modernism, which can't cope with the complexity which we have to kind of articulate. Can't be postmodernism or even hegemonic deconstructivism. They couldn't overcome the visual chaos that allows the proliferation of differences to collapse into global sameness and white noise. In a sense, both postmodernism and deconstructivism operate via collage, via the unconstrained agglomeration of differences anyway. So they don't want and can't kind of increase order. They degenerate order. So only parametricism, I believe, has the capacity to combine an increased complexity with a simultaneous increase in order via the principles of lawful differentiation and multi-system correlation, as outlined in my discussion of the taboos and dogmas of parameticism. So the final paragraph here is that the parameticist order does not rely on the uniform repetition of patterns as modern urbanism does in terms of establishing order, and a very kind of limited and simple order. Also, in contrast to the Baroque / Beaux-Arts master plans, parameticist compositions are inherently open-ended, incomplete compositions. Their order is relational rather than geometric. They establish order and orientation by lawful differentiation of fields, via vectors of transformation, as well as via contextual affiliation and subsystem correlations. I mean, these are the principles again. This neither requires the completion of a figure, nor in contrast to the modernist, a kind of repetitive continuation of a plan. So there's an incredible, I think, diversity, contingency, and richness and open-endedness in the process. And it could be very much multi-author. These are kind of single-author projects, and they remain relatively abstract. But I imagine, and this is a kind of multi-author project, that if each contributing architect, so in a sense I'm assuming that every building out there will be delivered, will be, of course, in terms of its program, location, investment, programmatic definition, a social profile determined by private clients, hiring architects, and I assume that the discipline has kind of gone through a transformation where parameticism and its principles have become hegemonic within the field. So they will have to, and it's not untypical to other disciplines where you have the sciences, you have global, these are world-spanning global discourses which evolve generalized global best practices, and I think parameticism delivers that in terms of its tool sets, intelligence, the kind of amount of parameters establishing. So would you imagine that every client will hire a architect who is working within that methodology with this ethos and a set of principles, which is about context sensitivity, resonating with context, continuing certain trajectories and continuities which have already been established in one of many possible ways. There's many, many ways in which you can continue a field, in which you can accentuate an already undercurrent of gradients operating through the field. And I believe that we can, and this is the first glimpse of a kind of multi-author project under a coherent set of methodologies, you can generate coherency, order, global city-spanning order, as well as local intricate orders that might be possible in a totally emergent bottom-up fashion, because these principles will be kind of diffused throughout a discipline, not through some kind of top-down indoctrination or imposition. We don't need kind of political power to thrust this through. This is something which will emerge out of our collective discourse, the pros and cons, advantages, what we inspired with, why we work, what we find convincing, and also in competitions what clients might find convincing. That's the way they think this will disperse and gain hegemony. So that term is maybe a little bit offensive to some of you, and I know, and no matter how much I talk here, I'm just one in thousands and millions of voices who have equal right and equal power to block and debate and post arguments. So that, but I still think that there's the potential of an emergence coherency, a trajectory, a movement, a paradigm, like you find in other disciplines, I would argue. So that's the thesis. Thanks.
Maybe if we all four of us come up and we'll have a more abridged discussion than we may have had, because I probably went on too long. Number of really provocative and really quite deep issues are brought up. I mean, I think the whole notion of thinking about the future of the city inevitably raises all sorts of paradoxes and contradictions. Some of them, you know, seem like they have a history to them as well. I mean, Chris, you bring up Aldo Rossi in this context as the relationship of, say, permanence and propelling, as he calls it, which I think in some sense the maybe more extreme, it's the sort of short-termism and the ephemerality of the city on one level, that it is inevitably about change, also about decay than just the celebration of growth and such. Is there a way to be really certain about the future, though? I'm looking at Patrik here.
I was thinking about what Chris was presenting, this kind of Rossi argument. There's a kind of structuralist setup, a dichotomy between fabric and monument, and then your assumption is, yes, that the monument can take various different historical eras, various functions which are have that share that structural moment of being elevated against the ordinary. So it's the public space of a market, or of a school, or of a council, political gathering, and so on. And I feel, yes, that is an interesting thought, and in fact that thought continues even within the parametricist logics, where we have certain structural multiplicity within a setup, where there's a certain, quite a large degree of reutilizability possible within the kind of the terms of the structural equation, as it were, can be replaced individually, but the overall relational matrix stays intact. This goes also for parametricism. But what I find problematic is that structural diagram, that equation, is a simple dichotomy, right? Yes, in the medieval city, you had only two categories. You had houses, it's not housing, houses, because houses were units, family units, which were both residential. That's where you had a place of production. That's where you had place of sale and exchange, as well as in the marketplace, let's say. So there was only a simple dichotomy. And then you had the public square, which had the church, come market, come political kind of gathering space. And so that's no longer viable in fact, even in the 19th century, and certainly longer in the 20th century. This diagram, which I accept that structuralism as an underlying, becomes ever more rich and complex and diversified, where we have not two things, but we have kind of a whole kind of network of maybe hundreds of things now, which need to be distinguished. And that can never be captured by that by that diagram, monument versus fabric.
Yeah, I think it's an interesting start here. I think that is why I think I didn't sort of just discuss Rossi and the Western European historical European city, because precisely I think the reason for bringing up these two models is not to say that we continue these historical models as a form, as a structure. But to show that actually, if anything, the way in which we look at the city, or the way in which we reason through the city, allows us to ask what is the common idea first, before we talk about what is the common form of the city. A lot that you said just now, even just 2-3 minutes ago, has to do with the question of formal coherence, right? And my question to you is, where is the genesis of this form? How do you substantiate this form in the discourse of the city? When you say they are coherent, they belong to the collective,
yeah.
How do you substantiate
it? I mean,
to
pick
them?
You up, let's say, we start with the classification. We start with typology, I would argue, as well. So you have this dichotomy of fabric versus monument. And now we kind of, we proliferate the typologies. And that what happened, you see, when you move to the from the medieval into the kind of
early capitalist city-states of the Renaissance, you have new players coming in. It's not this one community, it's now multiple noble houses, merchant houses, there's banks appearing, there's these palaces. In the next stage you have larger, kind of the absolute state, which has hierarchy between different cities, and you have large administrative bodies emerging. After the revolution you have institutions like universities, schools, museums, hospitals. You have many more types and types of spaces and types of institutions which need to be typologically differentiated, and that is massively expanded when we move into the 20th century with the social revolutions, where you have many, many more types of institutions, and so this repertoire that needs to be mirrored in some kind of a typological repertoire, and that therefore in modernism you have many more, and it becomes a kind of science. When I went to school, we had the topic of function types and typology. We had to learn, and there's a whole way of, you know, Persson wrote a whole book about all the function types of architecture. That's new. Now, beyond that, I think what is interesting, and I agree with Tom 100%, that we have to move from, as we move outside of modernism into post-Fordist network society, etc., we need to move from this typology into topology. But topology for me is not one kind of gooey blob, which is just quantitatively differentiated. I want to transmute the richness of a system of classification and add additional two, plus now each of these categories going through a series of variation internally, but then also transmutation and morphing from one into the other, and hybridization of some of these types. So the story becomes more complex, but I believe that the story starts with typology becoming topology, and in a sense we're going through the history of architecture again. When we describe the conceptual trajectory, this is exactly what has been discovered in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and so on. And we need to recognize that there is progress in this sense of an enrichment of the disciplines, categories, and way of working, which aligns with a more complex and rich society. And I find it highly problematic to kind of discard that and wanting the kind of conceptual simplicity. I mean, you've been with Pierre Vittorio and did your doctoral thesis with him, where he has this kind of strange cutoff point of precisely when it accelerates history, where he wants to freeze and say, none of this is relevant, I'm staying within 1975 as the last moment with Rossi. That I find highly problematic. And also I think with Marina, I'm always suspicious when somebody said it has always been there. And it has always been a kind of fundamental problem and category. And I'm always suspicious of that. I want to know what's different. If it has all been like this, why are we not staying with Vitruvius, and why are we having School of Architecture, why are we having an A? The point is, what's different, what's new, what's other? And that we need to grasp that and then have solutions for that. And that's why I'm kind of... I could not say harsher word, highly problematic what you guys are proposing.
Well, we can return to the audience.
Just to say, when we say they have always been the same, I don't think I refer to any typology or categories, but I was more referring to the questions and the concerns. And when we limit the always in the last 150 years, and I more started with a modern understanding of planning. So there are always
many messages that this is bankrupt. I mean, you have a wonderful thesis in the an essay which talks about, you give me the phrase, the collapse of our planning or something, or
Well, I'm gonna be on the fence here. I think in
somebody
some sense, I'm often accused, where I'm based now, of looking at China with so-called blue eyes as a foreigner, not really understanding, taking a kind of different history and kind of reading a new era of urbanization with an understanding of a history of, a, of another kind of urbanization. I think the book does try to kind of read the repetitive lessons of history of, of the relationship of industrialization, urbanization to urbanization. Yet, inevitably, what we're looking at is a very different kind of industrialization and a wholly different kind of scale within Asia of cities. It's and I think to it's difficult to reject either the lessons or the ways in which history kind of can be understood as either repeating itself in some ways, which it doesn't fully, but I think it does mutate to the extent that we're not looking at in any sense a kind of formulaic way of looking at either typology as a kind of mode of operandus, nor of any particular kind of era of architectural formulation. Now, I think what seems on another level problematic of a wave of urbanization of city building that has never occurred to the extent as in the last maybe 30 years or so, and will carry on for another few decades, is to pursue any agenda, I believe, that will try to, here's where I'm taking another sort of side of the fence, to unify or create a kind of singularity of, which might end up to create a similar set of effects of modernism. I'm doing a studio at Hong Kong U this semester where we tried to look at 100 cities, 108 cities, 12 students, and we couldn't get enough information. I have mainland Chinese students that couldn't even name more than 35 cities. So we did 36 cities, looking at 36 cities. Interestingly, they all seem to look the same. And I think that was the fundamental problem and the premise of looking at these cities. And if anything, there should be a way in which we pursue a distinctiveness and singularities and of each city in a sense of understanding urbanization as creating multiple differences in each city and quadrants of each city. And I'm not so sure why we need to kind of argue for a sort of unity.
Let's stay at the identity question.
Yeah.
Right? I think what I find is a kind of tragic condition in a sense that you have everybody and all the city planners craving for this identity and order and using to some extent old planning models, whether it's the kind of Bozar axis or the modernist grid. But since we cannot do physical planning like it was viable under the socialist planned economy, or even in the West we had kind of most of the infrastructure and built environment was centrally planned, these attempts to establish identity and order collapse, and you get this kind of garbage-filled sameness everywhere, no matter with or without plan. And that compares badly in terms of identity with the kind of, let's say, modernist creation like Brasilia, which has a very clear identity and structure. It's an iconic city, and which you can navigate and know where you are within it, and it has an overall image. And so, but I believe that when we have working with the principles we're starting to work with, we can generate local identities with these global principles because they have, for instance, the capacity, you mentioned Chongqing, the topographic adaptivity and specificity to tease out the kind of constraints that topography brings and particular solutions it brings. And it's also like an evolutionary process, it's self-enhancing. Once you have many options open to start, there are some constraints in the landscape, in the existing context, and you build on that, you give specificity to the particular climatic conditions on that relative to the topography, etc. You build up identities and self-amplifying identities and historical trajectories, which I believe will be distinct in each of the cities, while being operating on the same general and abstract principles, you will develop and unique graspable identities. And if we would pin up, and I have these slides, I will reduce myself here, the parametric urbanism 3 years of research, the projects, you recognize them in an instant, and so that each project represents different strong identity and recognizability, even if it's rich in its context. Of course, they all also become recognizable as parametric projects compared to others, but it's not like when I give you 20 photos of these garbage-filled cities globed, where they become indistinct unless you manage to recognize that one kind of funny icon which you remember. They all bleed into sameness. But if I put you 20 parametricism urbanism projects in there, they will stand out against each other, like the ones I had on that screen. And that is because they are kind of path-dependent identity amplifying trajectories we set up based on these rules, because the ethos is that precisely of stitching up connections, continuities, resonances, etc.
Yeah, it's your identity.
It's not my identity at all. Yeah. It's these 20s different, I'm talking
that
different
so
authors,
right?
Producing different cities, and I also believe multi-author. I'm saying it's not my identity at all. By the way, it was your project as much as mine and many people in the room that you kind of want to cut yourself off from your own history.
Adrian. So just a small question. I had a problem with the way you're using the term freedom. Is a free market for you identifiable with freedom?
Yes, I think the free market offers a lot of freedom, mm-hmm. to individual actors, entrepreneurs, I think it is an information processing system which has a much more fine-grained nuance, a capacity to feel out and respond to the much larger diversity of desires, interests, requirements, and so on. Yes, I believe in it's a freedom, but it's also information processing, and I think that it is part of this philosophy I'm talking about in terms of socio-economic philosophy. Based on Friedrich Hayek, is very, very congenial to this whole complexity theory paradigm, which we already absorbed in another way, which
gives you freedom.
Applied to social sciences.
Yeah. I think it gives you design freedom for yourself, right? But I do not think it gives the freedom when we talk about the project of the city. I think if we accept that the idea of the city, first and foremost, is the space of plurality, that is to say that it involves entrepreneur as well as the common citizen. I would argue that most of your projects is more concerned with the coherence of the container. That is to say that I think your project is more morphological than actually typological, because no plan of yours or your drawing of yours actually allows us to see the internal structure of those little elements, right? You're more concerned about the coherence of the overall form. Whereas when we talk about a typological approach is more concerned with the deep structure, because it's the deep structure that allows certain organization to manifest. The organization of the Georgian Terrace is always similar. That is why we are attending a lecture with a back room and a front room, right? The structure and the organization is always consistent. And as architects, if we understand this structure, then we are always able to allow smaller spaces in larger spaces.
I agree with that idea of
your
deep
approach.
I call
your
it deep relationality.
I think it's morphological, it's Severo Moratori, and in terms of this approach to the city, I think it's incredibly picturesque. It's not picturesque in the sense of
an image,
but one
actually
is concerned with the image of the city rather than the
internal structure of the type to
allow different organizations to unfold in the city.
I tell what I believe is in terms of typology, where I find Rossi is kind of fallacious. And therefore, you are fallacious, because you haven't stepped beyond that, is the fact that you and Rossi reduce typology
to morphology, in fact. You have basilica. These are abstracting from function types.
No.
And to some extent, that is, they're kind of morphological types.
No.
And I, my belief is that you have to correlate and look for correlations between morphological types and function types, even if they are temporary, in a syntax, a structural differentiated syntax of morphological types and function types and some kind of mapping. That's what I believe. And I believe also what you hinted at, that deep relationality, that the exterior morphology and even the positional location of a piece of the built environment needs to correlate and allow inferences, therefore, with interior structures and then finally with programmatic ongoings and interaction scenarios within that. So I believe that there is that deep relationality and between urban morphology and architecture, between facade and interior, but also between facade and street space and position of the street in a larger matrix. So I have all these hierarchies and layers. They should ideally line up and be inferable off each other. That's the relational urbanism, let's say, concept in the sense of a deep relationality. And you can't get that by sticking to archetypes. I think as far as Rossi is concerned, he is a theorist of archetypes, which only works from in a sort of limited historical period, and beyond that is no longer
This is where I disagree
viable.
again with you, precisely because I just showed you two slides, two examples that at the end of the day, when we begin to look at type, we do not relate it to function, precisely because with Rossi,
that's what's the fallacy. I want to have the audience come in, but I need to say, I loved your little description of Chinese fabric.
You need to let me finish. Then there was no discussion.
Okay, go on.
Right? So I just said, in those two examples, that if we look at a deep structure of type, it is independent of programmatic failures. It's independent of
function. Yeah, I heard that already.
Right?
I mean, that's
so
the problem.
So it is organization that is specific, right? So that's why I'm saying that the way you're approaching it is more morphological, it's not typological. And I also agree with you that, in a sense, that we shouldn't understand type through Pevsner, which, again, understand it through function.
Well, but you severing
I mean,
from function
and
you
bring it back to the
I need
the
to come back on this because sorry no I need to, I mean this is
and maybe we'll open up the question.
I need to
we'll bring it back to
I need thing. To refute that this second and not later. So and you can see it the way you argue, your only point is that you have that empty shell which is kind of infinitely refilled with function as long as it's fitting that structural dichotomy of public versus private. That's all you've got.
No.
And this is and this empty sign is infinitely refillable. And I think that's totally inadequate. And you need to have a dialectical discourse which includes form function correlations.
But I don't think any projects that we have created remotely looks like Rossi.
Yeah. Well, I don't know, you know, it's an interesting debate. But we can carry it on for a while. But I think what's shared in this debate is maybe an acceptance of whether it's a kind of position about the more form or use or the container or what's contained. I mean, I think these are also kind of highly architectural, limited to a kind of architectural understanding of the city. I think what seems shared is an appreciation for in terms of time, the limited duration of architecture. The fact that on one level is that architecture doesn't endure forever, or if it does, it changes the ways in which it's used. And I think that inevitably is an argument about adaptivity architecturally. I just wonder what the repercussions for urbanism is in this debate. I also, you know, to bring it back to the kind of issues about identity, heterogeneity within the 21st century, the relationship to the historic city is, of Europe, or even of the Americas, is a difficult problem to kind of apply towards urbanization in parts of the world that have very different kinds of histories. I think in some sense, I don't know, maybe the elephant in the room with the notion of identity and heterogeneity is Kenneth Frampton's arguments about against universalization. That of his argument of critical regionalism in the 1980s as a way to diagnose the death or the slow aging and dying of modernism. And I've been thinking a lot about this, this is already possibly an old book in a way of how it was formulated. And in some sense, the project of Frampton to kind of dissect the failures of modernism as a kind of universal approach, were on the basis of the world has different regions, different cultures, and it's the traditions and the vernacular of each region, which is what drives the differences from Brazilian modernism to Taiwanese modernism, for example. And I think that's on some level it's deeply flawed because it looks to history as what will persist and always differentiate the future. And rather than looking at a kind of cultural basis, I think, Patrik, what you raised earlier is the notions of a specificity of a context, not so much in terms of its architectural heritage, but maybe in terms of issues of topography, issues of specifics of density or morphology or of type or of, it's not to disclude culture and history necessarily at all, but it's, I think, to expand in a more methodological sense, a way of working towards more specific and distinctive kinds of urbanism in different places, different regions, different cities. Once again, in a time of history when we're building more cities than ever at a scale of what we could say is a city bigger than ever. I refer in this book to what Castells calls the Southern China metropolis, and in fact, it was a kind of dream of Castells and writing about 10 years ago that Southern China would have this big mega city. And actually, a few weeks ago, central government in Beijing announced that there's going to be a city of 100 million people in Southern China as a policy. I mean, it's which is quite staggering. So once again, we don't really have even the words to describe what that entails, let alone necessarily the methodologies with which to begin to specify and make and differentiate how that plays out to be interesting at all. Yeah. Maybe let's open this up to
Adrian?
Questions.
Yeah, I have a question. I think it's interesting because like a lot of the conversation is about like architecture not being able to secure some kind of common orientation for itself. And I think if I get straight to the point in terms of Patrick's presentation, I think there's a real confusion between ideas of difference and diversity. And I think on one hand, difference has to mean differences of spatial reasoning, right? And that if we eviscerate form from ideas of spatial reasoning, then form no longer has any meaning. And then we're left in a kind of game of kind of gradients of buildings being slightly higher or shorter, but finally, who cares? No? And when I say spatial reasoning, I mean something like the idea that all value could be monetized versus something like the city that Chris showed. So, and it's important politically, finally, because the idea that somehow what's collective or what's emergent secures an orientation to the good is like a very, very old philosophical idea. And the danger when it's transplanted from a kind of like, biological metaphors into architecture is that we forget that in human history, in fact, collective forms of stupidity are far as likely, if not more likely, than collective forms of intelligence. So there's a key political question here. For Chris, actually, I also have a question, which is, is there not a kind of sleight of hand in the idea of the deep structure, in the sense that on one level it asserts a kind of Platonism, no? In the sense that behind the kind of the concreteness of the city, there is some kind of essential quality. You know? And I can understand and see why that would work in cities that are highly coherent in their structure. But in fact, what operativity does something like that concept have in cities that don't obey any of those kind of structural irregularities?
So, very simply, then this structural irregularity that is the norm.
But how can the irregularity become a norm in the sense of?
No, I think it precisely is that I think the intention to show those two fundamental ideas is not that we need to return precisely to the exact model.
Yeah.
But all I'm saying is that before we act on the city, there is a certain underlying idea, there's a certain underlying structure that at every juncture within the city that the space of commonality is created. I think for architects, and I don't see that is the task that I only shoulder, but I think everyone else does as well, is to find what are the ideas that we hold in common today that enable us to talk about a common structure.
Yeah. Actually, I want to come in, the common structure, tie in with you to combat Adrian on that point. I mean, I seem to feel that the fetishization of diversity and that kind of collage richness is problematic because it is in fact there is more commonality and regularity underneath all these facades, which create difference. And behind there isn't all that much difference. But there is some difference we need to, and the diversity we need to encompass and grasp, which is much more than the 1950s had to encompass and grasp. Now it comes this way, where we do have more versatility of program, and I'm saying programmatic categories, institutions are no longer simple schedules of accommodation, labels, but they're parametrically variable event scenarios. They're still categorical. Now it comes back. No. I'm to finish the detail. So we need to first of all pull away that obfuscating veil of meaningless pollution, visual pollution difference, and get the diversification, and get to some kind of underlying lawful differentiation and ordering. And yes, you might be right. The initial massing model, which just shows different heights, that's not so exciting, but the point is here that deep relationality means that the peaks of height signify degrees of centrality. There needs to be correlations come with this. The height correlates with depths, correlates with position, correlates with internal sets of spaces and functions. So there's a whole series of correspondences which you now read off that which from a distance becomes first visible, maybe the height, maybe the silhouette, and so on. But the whole point is to kind of structure them and, to some extent, allow the a richly diversified, but still not infinitely diverse, societal institutional setup to sort itself into these offerings. So there's a structure where there's a kind of self-sorting. If you offer 100 different blocks which vary in depth, position, height, then you will have a kind of self-sorting into these, which will not be random, where you have the smaller grain, have the smaller companies, the larger grain has the larger companies. So I believe that there is, to some extent, you think it through in another way, you give material for self-sorting and self-organizing into something which has, let's say, to bring in another concept from cybernetics, which has requisite variety. You have the requisite variety right, and the kind of garbage spill has got it very wrong, and modernism, minimalism has it got it wrong, is somewhere in between.
But what you're describing is something that's internally consistent and systematic.
Yeah.
So I'll put my question another way. No. Can you imagine a difference that can receive no correlation?
Ultimately, if it is an individual instance of monumental importance, which cuts continuities and therefore pops out like a kind of spot on your white shirt, or because it will draw inordinate attention to itself. It should merit that, right? And but very quickly, we don't talk about singularities, there will be other versions of this, and this will be brought under rule, and the where it occurs, how it occurs, and so I believe it is a kind of, in an evolutionary process, a temporary positioning occurrence, but as you proliferate these, they will destroy and fall back everything into the garbage bill, but also it needs to merit this.
But we live in a world full of white spots on shirts.
That's the problem.
They're not easily reconcilable, translatable.
The problem is that I believe that I believe in the freedom of clients and entrepreneurs to purchase any piece of land and without any infringements of bureaucrats or regulations or second guessing what works, what doesn't work, which I think is fallacious. So I think there's a total freedom of defining what that particle should become, and the entrepreneur will take ownership and responsibility and also suffer the losses if he gets this wrong. But what I then don't believe, and he is totally free to hire an architect. What I find malicious in the concept is that he will randomly choose an architect, which makes an unpredictable way he treats that. He could have chosen an historicist, he could have chosen a minimalist, he could have chosen a deconstructivist, he could have chosen a parameterist. So it becomes, although he has a kind of well-calibrated institutional imposition into a network of positions, the architectural manifestation is random and creates garbage, spill, noise, and that becomes even dysfunctional for him. So that's where I'm coming in. I believe that the free market delivers this order, but it needs to be, they need to buy in a kind of disciplinary rigor, and which they would if the discipline had emerged, or what, let's say, what we are talking about, in which I think 5 years was a kind of on the ascendance heavily and was fortunately disrupted by the economic crisis, where we got distractions, you would face a kind of a coherent global best practice methodology, ethos, way of treating these, which would translate that sociological order into a kind of spatio-morphological manifestation. That's what I think we should, which could happen, and totally without bureaucrats. Because the bureaucrats, in the way we don't want them to tell the entrepreneur what to place, and therefore to misinvest this place, we also don't want the bureaucrats to tell us that we need to put used brick or red tiles or whatever fenestration. So the bureaucrats need to get out of there. But I think the free play of discourses and market processes could deliver.
But don't you think that in your master plan that the bureaucrat's position has been taken by you?
No.
Because you determine that the
tower and the... There is no... By the discourse. The discourse. I'm not the discourse. By the discipline.
But this is very abstract, because when you talk about the individual, which takes the freedom, or the freedom of the client, the freedom of the entrepreneur, how that would apply to the city, which city still... a place for a political space, space for the collective, or spaces for the collective. Someone has not the bureaucrats, but it's not either the free market or bureaucracy. Because I think you put it very black and white. How could one regulate the multiplicities?
Well, I think, of course, we're not there. There's contradictions in the system.
Forms of collective.
Yes, I agree, there are.
And the city is a form of collective. It's not a collage. And you mean collage in a very aesthetic way. So the city is not a collage, it's not an aesthetic entity.
I think the crisis that Patrik, you're talking about, it, of between the bureaucracies, the political forces that equate to, I don't know, the kind of technical bureaucracy of urban planning that predates or comes before, really, no, predates. It happens as a kind of process of deploying infrastructures and land subdivisions and such, particularly with new cities in Asia. I'm sorry, I'm taking the Asian position here. Which then is very much the sort of public, political, bureaucratic kind of mode of deploying infrastructure and land subdivision. And then come in the investors. I think that that split, I agree, is highly problematic. But I think, Marina, what you're raising is the potential for what is public or political to actually still reserve space in the city, literally and also not so literally, for what we don't have any other better terms for, of public space or that of the collective. And I think within a kind of model of pure investment model is at risk, because it either becomes entirely privatized, internalized, commodified. And I see that to a large extent in Asia, where public space is largely internalized into what can easily just be called shopping malls, or it's in such extreme vast spaces of exterior space that is maybe related more to a kind of more ancient cosmological model of the individual being subsumed in vast collective space. And I think there's a very different sense of the collective in different parts of the world. Mm-hmm. Certainly. Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, are there any other questions? Sorry.
Cool.
Yeah.
First. So then second.
Because you just mentioned a while ago, Kenneth Branton. Who on the one hand provides a clear insight on the need to understand the local specificity or localism somehow. But at some point in time in his career, he also realized that perhaps we were kind of like looking too much into the detail of the city itself, mm-hmm. as a city, as a project, as a sort of like dense core of the city, and then realized that somehow we have to be looking as well to the whole metropolitan condition or infrastructural condition outside, out there of the city. Where he has actually started to talk about megaform and started to realize that perhaps we have been thinking too much about the city itself. And not only him, but also other theorists were starting at the end of the mid-90s to realize that perhaps there's something around in the sort of like sprawling infrastructure landscape that we are missing if we focus too much on the city. And I'm not sure which of the tools that we have put here help us better or prepare us better to deal with a condition that whether we want it or not, it's kind of like here. I would perhaps argue that instead of putting the Masterplanning the Adaptive City, we could actually title the book Masterplanning the Adaptive Metropolis, perhaps. You know what I'm saying? Don't have to wait, try to recenter.
That's a 19th century word. That's a 19th century word.
Well, yeah. I don't know.
I think we struggle with terms to define what is the urban.
It is.
And I think you're including the rural or the suburban or the countryside.
If part of the tools we are describing in a way help us to move away from discussions about simply typological or morphological urbanism in the center of the city towards other problems that I don't know if we are touching. I think somehow. I don't know if we are missing part of the important point that I think can be opened with this type of discussion.
I just want to go back to the term topology and look at the city from a much more zoomed out, low resolution scale. One thing that I don't think has really been discussed or addressed is how these either or any alternative model to the ones that have been in place deals with adaptive change over time. So for instance, if you look at the typical city, I mean, there are exceptions to this, but in general, it's a two-dimensional plane. So it's a sheet topology. And if we develop a project, whether it's like quite a large site as a master plan or an individual building, whatever is done there is having an impact on, say, infrastructure. Like if we suddenly increase the capacity of the site, like by densifying it, it has an impact then on, say, street infrastructure, services, and all this. And I'd be interested to know whether you have a position on some of these things, because it seems that in order to argue for, like maybe this is particularly directed towards Patrik, but in order to consider in placing some kind of local order within a boundary condition, with the idea that it could potentially expand and change as it goes to do with things like topography and everything. Is there some other larger scale that you're advocating for to deal with that in terms of its change on the city? And I think this comes back to also whether we are you trying to address a master plan or a master algorithm in a sense as well?
Okay. Mm. No, it's not. It's neither. It's a master discourse and a set of compelling methodologies and a value system which arises discursively within the discipline, like modernism had achieved that value system. And it was global, and you could go anywhere in the world, and it was you could rely on it, right? There were clear value systems, methodologies, and therefore coherency. Now, but you can't go back to that. First of all, it's lost. But also, it wasn't capable. That's why it went to crisis to deliver the next stage of this complex post-Fordist network society civilization. So, but we need to go back to something like that, what I call the epochal style, which is a master methodology instead of a value systems. And I think that's what I'm talking about. It can't be reduced to master algorithm, but it will include a kind of the use, obviously, of many, many algorithms which correlate and translate each other, transcode each other, and to create these resonances. Now, coming to this issue of the city, and I believe, and there's a very interesting study about these megacities and about concentration as a criterion of productivity that I said earlier. Who stays in the provinces will be unproductive. Now, this is artificially maintained in a sense through planning. So cities like, or conglomerations, conurbations like Silicon Valley should be able to densify and intensify much more than they do. But there is a kind of planning restriction, not in my neighborhood kind of attitude, NIMBY attitude and political interference, which is kind of myopic on the individual, they're everybody warding off development and globally preventing that to intensify further. And then kind of and pushing, and that you always, the price system, I was talking about market process, the price system signals that irrationality, that because land values skyrocket and drive what wants to be there to other networks, to Dallas, to Texas, where in the end, a new startup has to think, can I participate in Silicon Valley, but I have to have that huge kind of rental and for living expenses, or I go here, and I know I'm disconnected, I compromise. And ultimately, these labor hours, these people, these investments are underinvestments, they're malinvested. Why? Because political interference is corrupting the market process, and the same is happening in London with, for instance, this interference with convertibility. We're talking about this convertibility from housing to office to whatever. They're impositions. That's why you have imbalances in value. That's why residential, for instance, is now double or triple per square meter than offices. This the market would never deliver that. The market would even out these. And would only positionality differences. So now the government proposes that you have free convertibility, and suddenly there are windfalls, and where these values will be equalized. But of course, each single borough of London is excluding itself from these rules, and we don't have that operating. So we're maintaining kind of irrationality, half underutilized, too much office space, and people like you guys and working for us, for instance, having to live and waste their time far outside because the supply is limited. So I think that shows that the market process would deliver much more rationality, effectively productivity. And I believe that under if we get the bureaucrats out of the way and the political lobbies, which I don't think it's kind of idealized collective, the political process is delivering privileges to special interests. That's what it's doing. And it's preventing an overall rationalization of the social process. And I believe that we would see much more intensified London. I think I would say the total whole of UK would end up emptying itself out into London, and that makes sense.
Do you think it actually work at that scale? Because what you're describing is a bottom-up system. It's almost that we develop an emergent order over time and come to a near equilibrium. But at the same time, London is comprised of very few owners, landowners. So the question is whether it's
I like that, and that's where I come. I want to have that key point, because I have thought it's the next for me is where I allow planning to come in. I reject politically enforced planning by people who have no real interest in the process, right? Who just got to follow rules or retire on the job in some bureaucratic kind of silo. They don't have a real investment and interest in what they're ruling over. What I believe in, where I think there might be chances where you, and that's a phenomenon we observe, that sites which are brought under a single investor or group of investors become larger and larger and larger, because then there is what I call private planning. And I believe in private planning, to some extent, as something where somebody is taking charge and looks at the synergies and congenialities and avoidance of disturbances, which the planning process doesn't really deliver, without hampering the potential by arbitrary rules and some presupposed good mixity between work and live. Where do they get these figures from? It's always conservative stabilization, special interest groups. I believe in market forces and in private planning to the extent that groups of investors can agglomerate larger sites in order to let's say, garner in synergies between different tenants, particles within a larger complex. So that could happen. I don't know where that ends. Maybe it ends into large parts of cities being privatized under single ownership. Why not? The whole steel industry was nearly under single ownership.
Maybe we'll take one more question here.
But we don't know.
There was already a question over here. So.
Yes.
I'd like to just go back a little bit to the discussion about typology. I think that one of the most controversial issues in terms of typology could be Rossi's understanding. Because this idea of finding a certain coherence in the different scales, I don't think that it's wrong, but maybe it's a matter of conviction or believing in a certain idea of the city. But what I don't think that it's easy to argue against is against typological reasoning, because it precisely gives you a powerful understanding of the deep structure of certain types and therefore of the city. And in fact, and taking what Marina said before, is that understanding the city through local identities, you can find like particular types, makes you understand that there's not a huge or an infinite range of types per every local, every city or even every country, whatever, right? Understanding topology instead of typology, I think that it's kind of erasing the problem of the common framework. So how do you think that it's possible to operate in the city through something common without, for example, typology?
I tend to think that a lot of what you're saying is highly relevant when one looks at cities that have existed for a very long time. And Rossi's position can be debated, but it's founded on the notion that the city has memory, and the memory and forgetfulness is a relationship between the physical material heritage of very old cities. His argument is really, I think, only possible with over long duration, you know, because of looking at the ways in which the memory of the city.
I'm protesting the same way. Let's remove Rossi from the discussion and discussing through topological reasoning. Yeah. That's what I'm trying to say.
Because, I mean, very simply to answer you, Tom, is that you seem to say that that way of thinking only applies to cities that are in existence. And I think perhaps that's one of the pitfalls to a lot of architects who are approaching China, they treat all these new cities as really tabula rasa. Yes, they are empty of buildings, but China is not empty of culture. It's not empty of political ideas, philosophical ideas. So the city should not just be understood as something physical, right? It is first a conception of collective space.
Sure, sure.
And behind them is a rich tradition of 2,000, 3,000 years of history. And part of the problem of a lot of architects just approaching China and treating it as tabula rasa, and therefore giving license for all this redundant formalism, is that it treats typology as the enemy, because typology is seen as only about the historical city, not at all.
Well,
but I think I have a real huge problem with the this idea of national Chinese civilization 2,000 years. I don't think that's relevant. I think that's a fallacy actually of a lot of Chinese clients and Chinese politicians thinking in these terms, because I believe in the globalized world, and I think we have differentiated cultures which have nothing to do with ancient origins, and all to do with how we fit in and engage in the world division of labor, whether we are scientists or we're part of the financial industry or we're part of the media industry or we're part of other kind of sub-industries. These are the different cultures, these are the different locales where these kind of productive hubs conglomerate and create unique identities. I don't think it makes sense to, and the problem is that you have, again, it's a tragic, nearly farcical unfolding in China. Everybody keeps harking on about this kind of Asian values and ancient culture, and despite all that, the result is that garbage spill sameness and undifferentiation. I don't think you can do this by beating the drum with, and I mean, I'm not sure, and I think all these kind of gestures towards some kind of hook of typological reference back to historical models is fallacious, misses the point, and in a sense misses the boat also then of, and anyway it doesn't do much. It's, you have little, you know what it, you get little Chinese hats on skyscrapers.
But
it couldn't be
otherwise.
It can't be if
you
take any other form.
Because now you misunderstand everything, and then you get on and then discourse. It doesn't exist. I mean, he didn't say that. He didn't talk about...
Why?
Well, but why are you talking about
Chinese hats?
Why do you talk about 2,000 years of civilization?
Let's talk about Chinese hats.
Your understanding
the relevance
of
that?
Chinese architecture is Chinese
no,
hats.
But why,
really
what's, the what's the relevance of what happened 2,000 years ago?
Why is it that when you refer to Western history, that is okay?
I don't relate to what happened in Germany 1,000 years ago. It's irrelevant to what I'm doing, and it could only hamper me.
So you relate to what then?
Yeah,
I'm only we are relating to the
to
contemporary
yourself.
Condition, not to myself. We're in a kind of discursive and market global process.
So to the market.
Yeah, the market and discursive currencies equally. It's not only the market, it's the internet, it's
when
the discourses.
When you said discursive, could you perhaps explain that?
The discourse of architecture, what I call the outposts of architecture, what the debates, the models, the images, the arguments which are circulating and which are followed or ignored, marginalized or proliferating, that's what drives what I think is relevant, and we need to look out for these currencies and convergences. I believe that's the kind of meta position where I said where I wouldn't want to have my own righteous position. I want to be in a movement which can kind of conquer positions and roll itself out, and I think we are part of that movement. So it's not and steer that. So I'm looking, I'm arguing critically within a trajectory which is always some kind of discursive collective trajectory to some extent. But it's not kind of my imposition. It's just my arguing within a trajectory which many people have participated in. So, but I don't think that's what I'm relating to, and I'm not relating, and the contemporary political conditions, socioeconomic conditions, technological conditions, conditions of communication, of sociology, and not what was 2,000 years ago. And I think we can learn nothing really, truly, by looking at what happened 2,000 years ago. So what we do need to know is how what we are doing now and what we are experiencing now is distinguished through a series of stages, so we can look backward in stages and steps to see where we arrived, and to get a glimpse of where this civilization might be going. And that's what I'm trying to do now. For instance, I'm kind of extrapolating, radicalizing what we have seen the last 30 years, that kind of neoliberal push of market forces, and see what's the next step in this trajectory. That's what I think is more relevant to saying there's something which was 2,000 years ago, which is Chinese civilization, which has an essence, which has something which needs to be embodied, which needs to be re-emerging. It's nostalgia. It's kind of bankrupt.
Well, I think it's on some level it's clear that there are diverse discursive positions here around the table and in the audience. I also would think that one common understanding of the market over the last 5 years, the market, is that it's not as intelligent as we give it credit for. It's as indeterminate as other sort of complex phenomena as climate or the weather. It's unpredictable. So I think to place a lot of belief in the market is possibly misguided, because it'll prove to be consistently unpredictable. I think there's some there within this bit of debate about maybe Asian urbanization in terms of the unprecedented scale, but also there's a kind of unpredictability of history and a lack of continuity of history in a sense of the history of urbanization. If one looks at maybe 19th century Europe, suddenly these huge metropolises emerge out of absolutely nowhere, and suddenly there's a kind of history that's broken, and I think that's occurring and has occurred to a large extent with Chinese urbanization. I think it's occurred in a way also that it's urbanizing a rural population. And I think there is a fundamental break with history in a sense of there isn't a continuous social structure. And I think it's difficult to kind of to then place the burden and the onus that there has to be continuity.
No, not necessary. But I think looking at history in forms of the present, that's the most basic thing. Mm. And also looking at China, I think we also cannot generalize the problems of the city. And I think Eduardo is trying to say here, what are the problems that we are approaching? And I think a lot of the discussion here generalizes the problem of the city. The problem of urbanization in China is completely different from the problem of urbanization here.
It's exactly the same.
I don't think so. Yeah, I don't think so.
With margins, of course, not, but much more similar than you make it out to be.
No, I don't think so, because, for instance, if you see the way in which China urbanizes, although we see there is almost complete freedom, but of course it's state orchestrated, number one.
I think it's difficult also to generalize one-fifth of the world's population in a country that large with such great geographic, economic...
No, I'm talking about the way, the model of urbanization. I think the model of urbanization has been argued by many great people. I think I'm not the only one. Fulong who's just across in your department has argued it very well in terms of the developmental city, and in which architects and consultants today is reduced to using design as a place promotion for this urbanization and do not actually create any meaningful forms of the city or space of the city. Of course, the way in which the developmental city is conceived in terms of the way in which China urbanizes is that the process of urbanization starting from 1978 is used as an economic generator in itself. Precisely because from 1978 onwards, economic liberalization, what the Chinese state has, and in which most cities or most nations do not have, is land. And of course, then land is placed to work, and of course, land therefore creates an economic generator in itself, which also means that, therefore, urbanization is completely speculative,
right? The demands are completely speculative. Now, within this rubric, there's a lot of different intricacy that moves from central government to local governments and different stakeholders and so on and so forth. Now, I wish there was more discussion about the question of freedom, the question of the challenges of urbanization, more specifically within the cities. And I see the way in which the model of development of urbanization in China, in a way, is not too dissimilar from what we see even before, or even in the imperial city, in which the state takes a moral position or a leadership position in creating cities.
Well, let me come in just for a moment. What I would argue for is not the absolute identity of the problems they're facing now and what the problems we have been recently facing, but there's a kind of convergence. Of course, since China was in the kind of communist backwater slumber for about 30 years and was anyway less developed going into that condition, they had an enormous catching up and urbanization because they were largely rural still in the late 70s. So, but as they have now urbanized, as they have already second, third, fourth generation of fabric, as they have evolved the middle class, as they have bringing in service sector industries, as multinationals set down in these cities and Shanghai becomes a financial center, it becomes a center of innovation where you have research and development hubs, it becomes more and more similar. So as they are catching up and maturing, they become very similar to the other advanced economies. It's still classified as an emerging economy, but I think we can see that gap. The demographics are changing. They're also an aging population. They're a few years behind. So they will be very, very similar in its with Japan and United States and UK. So London versus Shanghai versus New York versus Tokyo, these become, they're also directly competing now on a similar level. It's not necessarily a kind of, only the kind of back of house workshop and of the world. They become very, very similar. I think that will dominate any kind of reminiscing of some kind of deeper cultural difference. I think the cultural difference between Chinese population and, let's say, UK American population is far less due to some kind of ancient Chinese civilization. It was the difference between a kind of socialist way of life and mentality and understanding and a kind of capitalist one. So you have very similar adjustments and cultural transformations and learning curves in individuals you find in the Eastern Bloc Europe and in China, when they move from communism into late capitalism, if you like. That's what I think what matters. That's why you find that intense reacculturation, but it's not the generation of the students now, it's actually the generation of people in their 30s and 40s who made that through. I think that the current the cultural makeup of the 20-somethings is indistinguishable, nearly, I would argue, from the makeup of Europe, Latin America, US, this, I would argue. So I don't see that less and less unique kind of urbanization problems. It's becoming very much the same problem.
Maybe we're going to have to start to wrap up, but yeah. I mean, we could stay here till tomorrow morning and hopefully, yep. One person left here. But I think
we continue in the bar.
We'll all the urgent
questions, you can table them up there.
But I think one of the issues about Asian urbanization that I think is problematic within, say, the kind of political sketch that you're making, Patrik, is the short-termism. The short-termism of the political organization, the way it plays out in these sort of five-year increments, but also the model of investment. I live in a city now that's Hong Kong that has been built and torn down four times in the last century. And I think it's highly unsustainable on many, many levels. It's ideologically, it's a very unique, particular city that kind of had lots of land pressures and population pressures, and so there are reasons for why it was torn down so many times. But that happens all through China, all through the developed world urbanizes and tears itself down, and is inherently its gradualism is about the dysfunctionality of what gets built. And I think that's deeply problematic, and I don't think there is one particular approach or solution to that problem. But it's an issue in which it does relate to the kind of fundamental paradox or contradiction between design as a kind of form of control and the issues about permanence and endurance, which are deeply European values, not necessarily the control of but that of permanence, and a wishfulness for the kind of change and ephemerality of the city, which, you know, I think it's not a side one can take, and it's in fact that is the complexity of what we're talking about, of the inability to kind of fully plan or to find ways in which we can plan and design that allows for both adaptivity, resilience, heterogeneity, coherence, difference. I mean, there are some fundamental debates and discourses that are irreconcilable, I think. And I think it's great that there are these...
You forgot order.
Debates. Yeah.
Order.
Yeah, we do. Maybe we should carry
But it's emergent order, not top-down.
Upstairs in the bar. I'd like to thank Chris, Patrik, and Marina, and to all the contributors to this book and project, which are not here tonight, and really to an audience that has stuck with us for almost 3.5 hours. Thank you very much.